Well, thank you for coming back. It's been a long day. It's been a remarkable day. And as Lucia was saying, as soon as I spoke to her and she gave me the opportunity to make this piece, I was fascinated and excited by the prospect of coming here and making a piece specifically for this system. So that's what we've been working towards. And tonight with Luca at the controls at the desk as well, we're hoping to realize that. This piece is, I think, it'd be good if you could turn the phones off. This is something that I've thought about for a long time, this piece. It's Salmo, Salar, the three realms is my imagined journey of Atlantic salmon making their usually one-way trip back to the place where they were born, where they were hatched. And in this case, it's at the headwaters of my favorite English river, which is the River Coquet in Northumberland, high in the Cheviot Hills. The piece starts in the Barents Sea, or perhaps the Norwegian Sea, or perhaps the Arctic Ocean. It's where a lot of the salmon are now. They go there and they spend years there maturing and developing, and then they are forced by evolution to return to the place where they were born, at which point most of them die. So this is a single journey for nearly all of them. It's about a 3,000 kilometer journey, and this is about a 40 minute piece. And it takes us from, the piece opens in the sea ice border, somewhere in the high North Atlantic, as I said, or the Barents Sea, in that remarkable place where I made some recordings off the coast of Svalbard, the Norwegian archipelago, which is 80 degrees north, at a point when the water shifts from a solid to a liquid. It's quite a remarkable process. So it shifts from sea ice to sea water, and that incredible transition opens this piece with the salmon under the surface, and then we become part of the salmon's journey and encounter the sounds and vibrations along the way. That's the premise of this piece, the sound, my imagined sounds of the journey, but based upon a whole series of location recordings and what these animals may experience below the surface, and indeed the threats and challenges of making this journey, which they're empowered to do, back to their spawning grounds. So we hear the songs of bearded seals who predate salmon, these remarkable, haunting songs on the sea ice edge of these significantly large seals who will predate adult salmon. The salmon literally, zen-like, go with the flow, so the currents carry them down when they're starting the journey, past the Lofoten Islands, the Norwegian archipelago, particularly the island of Rost, where they pass and spend time in the vast kelp forests where their first association is with the plants that have been discussed today. That's a very dangerous place because, as Heidi Vesker knows and has worked a lot with the population of orca, the killer whales off that part of the archipelago. And what you hear in this piece, something I only heard for the first time yesterday when we were mixing and balancing this piece in the space, of what it must be like being amongst a pod of 200 orca, the most significant and probably the most intelligent animal on this planet, who hunt with echolocation and use contact calls to take the mature and adult salmon. The salmon then go past the Lofoten Islands and into the North Sea and arrive towards my part of the world, the Farne Islands off the coast of Northumberland, where they face another acoustic and predatory effect from grey seals. There's a significant population of grey seals around the Farne Islands, between 3,000 and 5,000, and it's believed there are so many there because they're sustained by the salmon migration, animals returning down to go up into rivers in Scotland and the northeast of England. Grey seals have this remarkable, haunting voice. I'm convinced any of you might have heard them. When you hear the songs of grey seals, in particular the females hauled out at low tide, you can hear the siren voices of mermaids, the songs that lured sailors onto the rocks over centuries on that part of the coast, the Isle of May, the Firth of Forth, the Farne Islands. The salmon eventually reach their home estuary, which in this case, for tonight, is the Coquet Estuary. And they do it by scent and taste, by finding the taste of their home river and the scent of their home river. Passing up through Amble, the port, and surrounded by eider ducks, which have this beautiful cooing sound. Eider ducks are no threat to the salmon, but it must be a sound that they would associate, or the vibrations below the surface, perhaps with returning to that place. Salmon, like eider ducks, have been around the Coquet Estuary far longer than we've been around. And they're certainly represented both with fossil remains and more recently, of course, in the Lindisfarne Gospels, where both animals are illustrated. The fish then pass up into their second realm, which is fresh water. I should have said from the start, the three realms of salmon are seawater, freshwater, and air. There are very, very few animals that can exist in those three realms. Some marine mammals, like seals, can do it. The salmon then pass up around Warkworth Castle, the home of Henry Hotspur, referenced in Shakespeare's Henry IV, who built a fish ladder to enable not only the salmon to migrate upriver, but also as a means of trapping them, because they were considerable medieval times, the 14th century, a considerable food resource, as would have been the bankside vegetation of the River Coquet. And the piece then passes higher up beyond habitation to the moorlands with the songs of a very special bird which enters two realms, a dipper, a bird that lives, of course, in air, sings by the riverbank, but enters the river to hunt for caddisfly larvae, and it has a particular covering over its eye, a nictitating membrane, which enables it to see focused underwater, a bird that would undoubtedly have witnessed the passage of salmon. The piece then rises higher up onto the heather moorland, where Maggie and I went just a few weeks ago to record the final part of this piece. I wanted to make a series of bespoke recordings at the source of the river. And at that altitude, the Coquet and its tributaries disappears into these finger of small channels across the heather and juncus. So the piece diffuses into a moorland chorus, which is happening now at this time of year, a place I was up with Pascal just a few weeks ago at a similar place. So you hear the songs and displays of curlew and redshank and golden plover and skylark, before finally getting to Coquet's Head and the source of the river, which for me certainly was I can recommend it. It's a magical experience to go and see water coming out through the sphagnum moss, the vegetation, and starting to gather in pools, the actual source of a river, to see this crystal clear water oozing out of the moss as you put your feet on it. And below that area is where the salmon spawn and eventually die. And I imagine, finally, the last realm that the salmon might enter is when their bodies are predated by ravens, which inhabit that area. Ravens, of course, are totemic animals, just like salmon are, both to North American indigenous people and certainly the Sami. So they're regarded as communicators between the spirit world, both ravens and salmon. I imagine the ravens taking the remains of the salmon and lifting their spirits aloft, similar to the idea of Viking spirits being taken to the halls of Valhalla. That's where I imagine the final place for these salmon to be, a fourth realm, which all of us have yet to experience. This is Salmo Salar. Thank you.
Thank you.